I'm Don Lemon. Thank you so much for joining us. And we have breaking news on the Russia investigation to tell you about. We're learning more tonight about what Robert Mueller's team is focusing on. Here's what sources are telling CNN. Now, the special counsel wants to question President Trump about four main topics so far. Anyway, four main topics. The source also says the president's legal team is creating a list of dozens of potential questions Mueller's team could ask. And with Trump already angry about the Mueller investigation and blasting it as a witch hunt, CNN has learned the president was fuming last night when news leaked that his national security advisors had warned him, in all caps, not to congratulate Vladimir Putin on his reelection. The president reportedly quizzed his allies and outside advisors, asking them to tell him who they thought was the leaker. One source says the latest leak contributes to an atmosphere of paranoia in the West Wing. But this is a president who doesn't hesitate to throw his own people right under the bus. Just ask Jeff Sessions. He doesn't hesitate to fire them as long as he doesn't have to do it face to face. Just ask Rex Tillerson, not to mention James Comey or Michael Flynn and a host of other people. So what's behind all these leaks? Is it about fighting back or is it for the good of the country? Then there's this. This is from the former director of the CIA, John Brennan, telling MSNBC he thinks President Trump is afraid of Vladimir Putin, and going on to say, quote, the Russians could have something on him personally that they could always roll out and make his life more difficult. There's no public evidence of that, but it's a pretty stunning statement by an intelligence professional, right? I'm going to ask another former CIA director, Michael Hayden, about that. Plus, we have new developments in the lawsuit filed by a former apprentice contestant against the president. Trump's attorney plans to appeal a judge's decision to allow the defamation lawsuit to go forward. Her name is Summer Zervos. She says Trump groped her in 2006, and she says he defamed her by calling her a liar. More on that later on in the show. A lot to get to, but I want to bring in CNN senior White House correspondent Pamela Brown. Pamela, good evening to you. You can see Pamela's live at the White House this evening. I hope you're warm out there in the middle of this snowstorm we're having here on the East Coast. You know, you're getting new details about what Mueller's team has discussed with the president's attorneys. What are you learning?
That's right. Don, the special counsel investigators have indicated four main areas that they would like to discuss with the president during a potential sit-down interview. They include the president's role in crafting that statement aboard Air Force One to miscast the meeting that his son had at Trump Tower with Russians in June of 2016. They also want to know more about that meeting at Trump Tower that Don Jr. had with the Russians and what the president knew about it. As you know, the president has said he didn't know anything until much later. But clearly, Robert Mueller's team is interested in that, according to sources. They also want to learn more about the circumstances surrounding the firings of former FBI Director James Comey and former National Security Advisor Michael Flynn and the president's actions there. Now, a source familiar, Don, says a bulk of what Robert Mueller's team is looking to speak with the president about has to do with those firings. And from all of this information, the president's legal team has basically put together a memo of dozens of potential questions that the president could be asked. Now, whether there will be an interview, it remains to be seen, Don. In fact, I'm told by a source that the president's legal team is looking to add to its ranks more lawyers as it enters this next phase to decide what will happen. One thing is for sure, though, Don, the president is growing increasingly agitated. As we see here, Robert Mueller wants to talk to him about his own behavior. This is about the president himself. That is something that has been frustrating to him. Sarah Sanders at the podium yesterday, I was asking her about Robert Mueller, the Russia probe. It was clear she's frustrated, saying that the president has been mercilessly attacked. So we'll have to wait and see how this plays out from here, Don.
So given that, any sense of a timeline on how soon could the president potentially sit down with Mueller's team, Pamela?
Well, I'm told, Don, that there could be a decision made just within the next couple of weeks. So that is why one source said we're entering a new phase here. We need more people, more lawyers to try to sort of make this decision to decide how to handle this from here. The president himself has vacillated. I'm told that he initially wanted to come out and sit down with Robert Mueller. He said it on the record in January that he would love to do it under oath. But now, as it's becoming increasingly clear what Robert Mueller wants to focus on, the fact that this probe is not slowing down, the president sort of is getting different advice advice from lawyers, so we will have to wait and see. But a decision on whether or not it will happen, whether his lawyers will allow it to happen, is expected to be made within the next couple of weeks, Don.
Pamela Brown, much appreciated. Thank you so much. I want to bring in now CNN Politics Editor-at-Large Chris Saliza, CNN Political Analyst Ryan Lizza, CNN Contributor John Dean, the former Nixon White House counsel. I got to get my Salizas and Lizzas right this evening.
Tough, well done.
It can be confusing sometimes. So that said, I'm going to start with John. Good evening to all of you, by the way. John, so CNN is learning about these four main focuses, the focus area that Mueller is interested in talking to the president about, with particular interest in the president's actions related to Comey and the Flynn firings. What type of case does this sound like to you? Is it an obstruction of justice case, given what you know?
Well, there certainly are some questions there that would directly relate to a obstruction case. But, Don, I don't think we really know what he's going to ask, and he's not going to be bound by any agreement as to what he'll ask. He's going to go where he thinks he needs to go. He's going to go within the four corners of the general charge he's got from the Deputy Attorney General as to what he's to investigate, and he's not going to be restrained. So I don't think we can really figure out what's going to happen in that session.
Mm-hmm. And the backdrop of the new details we're learning about today is the president's Twitter tirade against Mueller and the investigation. That's the backdrop here.
Yeah, and I think it's important to remember, Don, this is a pressure cooker. Last night we were talking about Summer Zervos, Karen McDougal, and Stormy Daniels. Now this. The Putin phone call. Donald Trump says he likes to operate in chaos. He believes that that's the way in which he works best. He thinks it best ideas come out of that. But I think what you see is Twitter has always been his pressure release valve. It's the thing that no one can ever take from him, despite people trying to many times over. And I think you'll see that increasingly. We saw some of it this afternoon. We've seen some of it over the last few days. I think you'll continue to see that because I think he's getting increasingly frustrated, pressure on, less staff he can rely on. Remember, Hope Hicks on her way out, less people he trusts around him who don't have other conflicts they need to deal with that their minds are focused on. So I think you're going to see him turn even more to Twitter to express himself, which probably is against the advice of his lawyers, but yeah. When's he listened to them?
Well, you mentioned Stormy Daniels. He's not turning Twitter for that.
No, that's a whole
that's a whole nother show.
Whole other panel.
And that's later on in this show. So let's stick with Russia now and Mueller. And I'm going to ask you about the four areas. But let me just read them quickly before I ask you, Ryan. I almost called you Chris Ryan. The president's role in crafting the statement aboard Air Force One, right, that miscast Donald Trump Jr.'s campaign at the 2016 meeting. The circumstances surrounding the Trump Tower meeting, as well as that, the firing of the FBI Director James Comey, and the firing of National Security Advisor Michael Flynn. So those are the ones that, so those are the what they're talking about now. So his interests go beyond those four topics, though. Don't you think it goes beyond that? So it goes beyond just simple collusion, I would think, that it points to. And that's why I asked John about, is this an obstruction case? So this is not ending anytime soon.
It's sprawling. Just think of all the buckets here. Number one, it gets to the basic issue of collusion. Two and three on your list get to more of the obstruction of justice. Four, I think, is one that's gotten a little bit forgotten in the recent months of a lot of news, is this Flynn case and whether Mueller is looking into a Logan Act violation. Remember the Logan Act?
We were talking about
that. And you go back and you read the filings in the Flynn case. Remember, he admitted to lying to the FBI. There's some interesting clues in there. He talks about a very senior official in the transition who knew about the conversations he was having with the Russian ambassador. Mueller has been focused on those conversations, and he wants to know who told Flynn to say what to the Russian ambassador. We don't know who that very senior official is. Is it Jared Kushner?
Right.
Is it Pence? Is it Trump? So I think that's something that we haven't talked about in a long time is, and remember this Logan Act that's been on the books for centuries but has not actually been enforced much, but it's basically, are you conducting a foreign policy independently that tries to thwart the current American government's foreign policy? That's what Flynn was on his way to being charged with when he admitted to the lie. Anyway, so that's one bucket. And then the stuff outside of that list, we have this recent issue of the subpoena to the Trump Organization. So, right, is Mueller now looking at something that the Trump Organization did completely outside of Russia or, you know, related to Russia. And so that's a lot of issues. And then we still don't have any indictments. I think the most obvious indictment from what we know publicly is going to be something related to Russians who were involved with the hacking and dumping campaign of the DNC and Podesta emails. Yeah. So this investigation is going on for a long time.
Can I just highlight one thing? Because I think, Ryan, we lose sight because so much happens, right? Yeah. We talk about this all the time. So much happens every day. You lose sight of it. But the Flynn plea deal and cooperation, I think, is of huge import. You know, it's not the most recent thing that happened.
What was one?
But that's a major
one of the first things I reported. Flynn was fired or let go.
That's a huge deal because of all of them, whatever you think of George Papadopoulos, whatever you think of Rick Gates, there is no question that Michael Flynn was there at the beginning, roughly. Yeah. He was there in the central part of the campaign. He was in the leadership team. And then he was the national security advisor in the White House. So that plea deal and cooperation pledge, the belief by Mueller that Flynn knows enough that a plea deal is worthwhile, and then Flynn's cooperation, do not underestimate that. I think that may be a key piece.
Well, let's bring in the man who would know about that. John B. sitting
Neither
right
of us
here.
Ever handled that.
I know. So,
like
John.
Seen in the Woody Allen movie. We've actually got the person right here.
And if you agree with that, John, that's a lot of legal landmines for the president. No wonder the president's like, oh, my gosh, can't this just be over with?
For sure. One thing also, if you take all this, put it together, what you're really looking at is a grand conspiracy. And those are the counts that he's raising, for example, in the 13 Russians he charged with conspiracy, with the Manafort case and the Gates case. Those were conspiracy cases. So he's actually building a defraud the United States case that could be both domestic and foreign, and it's what would be known as collusion in another term.
So given collusion in another term, but is it surprising to you that he is focusing on things, John, that happened after the administration was in place instead of before the election when there was some sort of collusion? Because, I mean, it does fall under the scope, but it appears that he's focusing on actions after the presidency.
If you recall the way that he picked up the investigation was in progress when Mueller was appointed. So there was an ongoing investigation he was asked to complete. The thing that prompted his appointment was the firing of Comey. So it's not surprising that's one of the things he's looking at. And it's one of the things that certainly suggests both his dealings with Comey and his firing of Comey, obstruction of justice. That's one of the reasons I think that's been one of the later focuses of his attention.
So, John, again, having been there, right, for Nixon, so take us behind the scenes at this White House and with the, you know, the advice that the president is being given, you know, is he on an island by himself? What is going on now in his head?
He's very frustrated by leaks. That's apparent. And every president, to a degree, has had that problem. Nixon had that problem long before Watergate, and many people think that's one of the things that led to Watergate. He put wiretaps, for example, on White House staffers, national security staffers, newsmen. He couldn't determine and find the leakers, however. So I'm sure Trump is thinking about all those things, but hopefully somebody has told him it really doesn't work very well.
Chris, you say the real story here, though, I mean, we've been talking about the leaks, and he's upset about the leaks or whatever. But you say this, that, I'm sorry, Ryan, not Chris, Ryan. The dysfunction is, the story is dysfunction in the White House. That's the story.
Well, I think that is. And I don't know if I said that or
that was probably me.
But I would have
said that. Parking lots everywhere,
you both said
it.
I would have said that.
Yeah. Basically interchangeable.
Well, what did you mean by it?
So, it was me. Although I take credit for all the good stuff that Ryan writes in The New Yorker. I take credit for all the time. People are like, the Anthony Scaramucci stuff. I'm like, sure, that was me. Anyway.
Too soon.
That was
me. Yeah,
exactly.
Never
too soon.
Yeah, too soon.
The point I was making about the dysfunction is that someone in what is a relatively small circle of people, theoretically, who knew the contents of the call between Putin and Trump and who knew the briefing papers and what they said, the do not congratulate, it's not that big of a world.
Yeah.
That within couple hours of the phone call happening, the Washington Post had that he had, number one, had congratulated him, and number two, had not brought up the poisoning of an ex-Russian spy.
Right.
suggests that there are people who are not some junior subordinate, someone relatively close to this president at a relatively high level, who believe that is the only way that you can effectively communicate with him, to sort of publicly embarrass him.
Well, that was my
because
point.
He won't pay attention otherwise.
My point last night with Scott Jennings, is that he keeps saying there's some sort of deep state, because that was Scott's point last night. There was this deep state, and that was someone who's, you know, people who are not necessarily close to the president, who had been there for a long time. This is someone who's close to him, probably he appointed, who's...
Deep state is another word for, you know, often career professionals who are really scared about where this president is taking us. And when I saw that report, it is shocking. It is amazing to see something so close to an event and such a private, closely held document. It seemed like, frankly, a whistleblower. Someone was saying, we think Russia policy is crazy right now. This guy just poisoned someone in the UK. He won a fraudulent election. He's paid no price for meddling in our democracy. And the president just gives him a call and like they're buddies. It feels like someone who was saying this has to stop and wanted to go public with not everyone over here agrees with him on this.
I got to run. The calls are coming from, John, as we always say, the calls are coming from inside the house. Right? Thank you. Thank you, Ryan, Chris, and John. I appreciate it. When we come back, does Vladimir Putin have professional dirt on President Trump? Former CIA Director John Brennan says he might. I'm going to ask another former CIA boss, Michael Hayden, what he thinks. And in a bit later, we're going to hear from Facebook's Mark Zuckerberg, speaking exclusively to CNN.
CNN Tonight, brought to you.
President Trump is defending his phone call with Vladimir Putin, a call in which he congratulated the Russian president on his reelection, but apparently didn't mention accusations that Russia used a nerve agent to poison a former Russian spy in the UK. He also apparently failed to mention Russia's election interference. But we're learning tonight that one of the things the president did mention reportedly blindsided his senior advisors. Join me now, CNN National Security Advisor, General Michael Hayden, CIA Director under President George W. Bush. Thank you, sir. Good to have you on. Appreciate it. Yeah. There's new reporting tonight from the Washington Post that Trump's senior advisors were thrown when he told Putin that he expected to meet with Putin soon. And several officials are telling the Post that there's no plan for a meeting. That wasn't in the briefing material. Does it sound like the president has his own Russia agenda here?
I think the president is spontaneous, unstructured, doesn't take to coaching very well. I think that just came out, Don. And now, like many things, you get this statement from the chief executive, and now the staff either has to walk him back from it or implement it. And we'll see which of those two dynamics apply in this particular case. You know, meeting with Putin isn't quite as bad as meeting with Kim Jong-un without preconditions, but it does seem to give Putin credit he doesn't deserve, particularly after some recent things that we know Putin did.
Yeah. General Hayden, the former CIA Director John Brennan says Russia may have something on Trump. I want you to take a look at this.
I think he's afraid of the president of Russia.
Why?
Well, I think one can speculate as to why, that the Russians may have something on him personally, that they could always roll out and make his life more difficult. The Russians, I think, have had long experience with Mr. Trump and may have things that they could expose.
Something personal, perhaps?
Perhaps.
Do you think that's a real possibility, General, that Putin has something on Trump?
Look, anything's possible, Don, but John admitted quite candidly that he was speculating here. So let me just try to parse out some potential explanations for why the president doesn't seem to have it within him to criticize Russia or Vladimir Putin. You know, when I got to a communist country in the mid-1980s, communist Bulgaria, my predecessor warned me my first day there. He said, you know, you'll be a lot better off here if you do not attribute to malice that which can equally be explained by incompetence. And you know, there could be a fair amount of incompetence when it comes to the president making it up in terms of his relationship with Putin and with Russia. There are a lot of things he doesn't know, Don, and more frighteningly, it appears that he doesn't know that he doesn't know. Mm-hmm. Now, this may just simply be bad performance. Now, if you go over here and talk about what John was talking about, how are the Russians attempting to influence him? We've got this little mnemonic that we use, MICE, M-I-C-E, mm-hmm. money, ideology, compromise, and ego. And if I'm looking at those four approaches, if I'm the Russians looking at Donald Trump, I don't know that I would instinctively go to compromise. You know, it's awfully hard to embarrass the president. He blew right through that Access Hollywood tape, hardly without blinking. If I was going to try to work to influence our president, if I were a Russian, I think I'd go to ego.
Ego.
And right. we have seen Putin go out of his way to praise President Trump.
Were you surprised by the former director Brennan's comments, General?
I was a bit, but look, John is a very straightforward guy. Mm-hmm. He speaks his mind. John's a good friend, but he and I have had some sharp conversations because he's very candid.
Yeah. So, General Hayden, we pulled just a sampling of the president's tweets, and we all know that there are many, many, many more, many more. But he attacks Democrats, Republicans, he attacks Mexico, China, Iran. He's dissed our allies like the UK. He's attacked Nordstrom. He's attacked me and others in the media. But there's never criticism of Putin or Russia. What explains the president's pro-Russian views?
Don, you go back to that little mnemonic, M-I-C-E. Let's go to I. Ideology. And here I'm not talking about post-Marxism or anything. I'm talking about a kindred spirit between the President of the United States and the President of Russia when it comes towards a trend towards autocracy, the strong man, that kind of approach to governance. I really do think there's a convergence in terms of how President Trump would like to govern and how President Putin does govern. And so because of what's the right word here, Don? Respect, admiration. Mm-hmm. The president doesn't seem to want to go out and attack someone whom he seems to actually have a great deal of respect for.
Mm. I just want to read some of the president's tweets from this morning, okay, defending his congratulating of Putin and get your take on it. I call President Putin of Russia to congratulate him on his election victory in past. Obama called him also. The fake news media is crazed because they wanted me to excoriate him. They are wrong. Getting along with Russia and others is a good thing, not a bad thing. They can help solve problems with North Korea, Syria, Ukraine, ISIS, Iran, and even the coming arms race. Bush tried to get along, but didn't have the smarts. Obama and Clinton tried, but didn't have the energy or chemistry. Remember, reset, peace through strength. General Hayden, there's a lot to pull apart in that
tweet.
There really
is. I mean,
but, you know, what stands out to you?
Well, a couple of things. Number one, he blames a list of people for bad Russian-American relations. None of them are Vladimir Putin, which is really, really quite striking.
Yeah.
And then he blames you and your colleagues, Don, for making war on him, for trying to make nice with the Russians. You guys didn't write in capital letters, "Don't congratulate him." That came from his own intimate personal staff, the staff that he hired.
Yeah, and we didn't congratulate Vladimir Putin on the phone call, but it's just interesting to me when you have, you know, highly respected people, and, you know, and listen, I respect all of our presidents, President Clinton, President Obama, President Bush, who I'm sure when they were in office worked their damnedest to try to figure out a way to negotiate with Russia. He's attacking them rather than attacking someone who is supposed to have just killed someone with a chemical weapon in the UK.
Yeah, and it's amazing. You talked about the tweet. I think fact of call was the first mistake. Mm-hmm. It's too soon after the attempted murders in London. And then making the call without bringing those up at all, I think, is another unforced error on our part, Don.
General, always appreciate it. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
When we come back, the president is furious over leaks coming from inside the White House. He's renewed his demand for loyalty from his own staff. But can he expect loyalty when he publicly berates staffers and cabinet members and outright ignores their advice? Does Stormy Daniels have the president's number? It sure seems that way. The adult film star is tweeting up a storm about her relationship with President Trump. Yet the president, who routinely vents on Twitter, has yet to mention her name. Sarah Seidner is covering this story for us this evening. Sarah, good evening to you. Stormy Daniels is on a tear on social media. What's she saying?
She is. It's like a grudge match watching her go after the trolls that come after her. Recently, and it's kind of the first time, Dawn, that we've seen her talk in detail, at least a few, about her relationship with the president. Here's a tweet that she put out just yesterday. She says that technically, I didn't sleep with POTUS 12 years ago. There was no sleeping, and he was just a goofy reality TV star. But I digress. People do care that he lied about it, had me bullied, broke laws to cover it up, etc. And P.S., I'm not going anywhere. So that is the first time since her lawsuit was filed that we actually heard her make those accusations herself. And then when people come after her, and they do a lot, she goes right back at them, someone accusing her of taking money for the 60 Minutes interview that she is going to be doing, or that's going to air, that she has already done. Here's what she said about that. She said, look, I did not take any money for the 60 Minutes interview, not a dime. So she's responding as she always does, but she seems like she feels freer to say something about it. And those are just a few of her tweets. I mean, she goes on and on and on, battling people back and forth who are calling her all sorts of names, and, you know, basically coming after her for being a porn star. She's also a director, and she's not having it. So she is quite a fighter, if you will, if you look just going by her Twitter and from what some of her friends have said.
And a smart lady. Again, I say it every night. She grew up in my hometown. She went to a magnet high school, so she ain't no dummy.
She's a businesswoman.
Yep. Thank you very much, Sarah Seidner. I appreciate that. I want to bring in now CNN legal commentator Ken Cuccinelli, CNN legal analyst Areva Martin, the author of Make It Rain, and CNN political commentator Ana Navarro. Hello, everyone. Good evening. Good to have
you on.
Ken, you're up first. So Stormy, in her own words, isn't going anywhere. What do you make of the fact that she is not backing down? If anything, she is ramping up the attack.
Yeah, you know, I find it that is interesting that there's more detail and more direct comments coming from her now. And this is all behind, on the other side, the side we see, of a legal dispute over a contract that we really don't know how it's going. And so she's either feeling more confident or getting released to some degree or another. It's not really clear. And it doesn't matter substantively for politics, but it certainly dominates discussion, and it's not a favorable topic. So.
Well, let me ask you then, dominating discussion. I mean, Stormy Daniels and her attorney, Michael Avenatti, they're playing by Donald Trump's playbook, don't you think? I mean, he's the ultimate reality star.
In some ways, they are. Sure.
They've maintained a constant presence.
Yeah, and it's interesting, and on Twitter, which has been like a forum he has owned for the last 2 years, 3 years, and yet he's not responding. So I think he's presumably just trying to protect himself legally and maybe actually taking lawyers' advice in terms of not picking up the Twitter sword there. But it's unusual for him. I mean, normally it's damn the torpedoes.
Yeah, he's ceding that territory, Ana Navarro. I mean, don't you think that the media territory, he has never been one to shy away from confrontation, but it seems he's awfully quiet when it comes to Stormy Daniels and his other female accusers. What's going on?
Because if he talks, it's even worse for him. He's going to, show just how much under his skin this is. She is not going away. She is not going to be silent. It is unprecedented. It is unseemly. It is surreal. I kind of feel like we are watching this endless loop of, as the world day turns, as the Trump world turns, this is a telenovela night after night that we are all watching. And the reason he can't engage with Stormy Daniels is because she's got his number. She's got texts. She's got other stuff. He can't beat her at his own game. This woman, girlfriend, knows how to manipulate Twitter. She knows how to tease. She knows how to give it to us drop by drop and keep us entertained and keep us engaged. She knows how to communicate directly with people using social media. And nothing makes a dent in her. Nothing nicks her. Yeah. She's used to her entire life, because of her career, of being stereotyped, of being called names, of being insulted, of being this, of being that. She doesn't care. She's not afraid of him.
The president's lawyers are
a beautiful thing to watch.
The president's lawyers obviously advising him of what to do. Are they? You think they're telling him not to do it? Because Areva, he doesn't often follow that advice as well. But What are they telling him?
Yeah, I was getting ready to say, Don, I don't think this is about the president's lawyers telling him not to engage, because Trump never follows the advice of his attorneys. He gets involved in all kinds of disputes, including legal disputes where he should not be involved. And we have to look at what happened here. Michael Cohen had filed this action, kept saying that Trump knew nothing about it. He knew nothing about the settlement. He knew nothing about, you know, this entire action. Trump voluntarily jumped into this matter. He made himself a party to this action to remove this matter from state court to federal court. He didn't have to do that. He could have remained on the sidelines. He could have let Michael Cohen and Stormy Daniels' attorneys fight this out as they were and remain on the sidelines. He jumped into this. He now doesn't have the ability to say he doesn't know about this lawsuit. He doesn't know about the settlement. He doesn't know about, you know, the negotiations over this $130,000. I don't think he's taking the advice of counsel. I think he's afraid to go after Stormy Daniels because she has too much damaging evidence on him.
Well, we're going to hear from Stormy Daniels and some of the other accusers of President Trump, or when he wasn't president, of Donald Trump, right after this break. So we're back. We're talking about more developments in another in legal cases against President Trump. And let's get back to the group here. So listen, Stormy Daniels sat down with an interview with Anderson for 60 Minutes, and it's supposed to air on Sunday night. A short teaser. Here it is.
Hey, nice to see you. It's pretty nice. See, I guess I'm not 100% sure on why you're doing this.
Now, that's a teaser, Ken. What do you think she's going to say?
Well, it depends whether she gives a square answer. I think it was commented, you know, she's basically a businesswoman in this context. And if she gives that sort of an answer, hey, this is promotion, man. She's doing it thoroughly and effectively and sort of steadily. Anna said, you know, we're getting the drip, drip, drip. And I think that's true. And from that perspective, she has kept herself in a spotlight and at the center of news, and if it continues on a mere drip, drip, drip phase, it's going to be for a while.
Yeah.
And, you know, some short version of that answer, I think, would be the full and accurate answer.
Okay. I want to get this stuff in. So, Ariva, today President Trump, his attorney Mark Cassowitz, announcing that he plans to appeal a New York Supreme Court judge's decision to allow a defamation lawsuit against the president to go forward. Defamation case was filed by the Apprentice contestant Summer Zervos, who claims that Trump sexually assaulted her in 2007. This is what Cassowitz said to CNN today. He said, "We disagree with the decision, which is wrong as a matter of constitutional law. We intend to immediately appeal and will seek a stay of the case until the issue is finally determined." Will Trump be able to avoid this deposition, or will he have to face her in court?
I don't think ultimately he's going to be able to avoid participating in discovery and having to answer questions under oath, Don, but clearly this gives his lawyer another bite at the apple. It gives him another opportunity to delay this lawsuit. One thing that judge in New York said was he had to answer that complaint within 10 days. So there was a short window of time in which Donald Trump had to, for the record, state what his response to that complaint, that defamation action, was. Yeah. Now, presumably, this appeal gives him an opportunity to delay this matter, and that's what he's been trying to do. He asked the court to dismiss the action. He said, look, Your Honor, he's a sitting president. This is going to be disruptive to the presidency. The judge rejected that argument, but now he gets an opportunity to make that argument again to an appellate court, and he may be able to dodge a bullet temporarily. I don't think permanently, but for the moment, he's in a position where he won't have to answer that complaint.
Anna, listen, I know you've been talking about this, about how your party, the Republican Party, really sort of turning a blind eye to this. I mean, if this case does go to trial, how damaging could this potentially be for the president and for the party?
Look, I think the party has done itself so much damage over and over again when it comes to Donald Trump, because they continuously look the other way, whether it's the Russia stuff, whether it's the call to Putin, whether it's, you know, hush payments to a, you know, to Stormy Daniels, whether it's non-disclosure agreements. Do you think that if this had happened under Barack Obama, this wouldn't be investigated right now by a Republican Congress? We all know what the answer to that is. The answer to that is yes. Do you think that if it had been Barack Obama who had called Putin, Republicans wouldn't be screaming from every hilltop today? The answer is yes. So I think the Republican Party has revealed itself, with some very honorable exceptions like John McCain, to be hypocrites. to be inconsistent, to have no memory, to all be suffering from severe amnesia. And, you know, as to your question, why he doesn't engage Trump, Stormy Daniels, he engaged Michael Wolff. He tried to stop Michael Wolff. He tried to get into a Twitter fight with Michael Wolff. And you know what happened? Michael Wolff sold over 2 million copies of a book that's based on nothing but innuendo and gossip. If he engages Stormy Daniels, I mean, we are all going to get over our withdrawal symptoms from the last season of Scandal, because we're all going to be tuning in with a big vat of popcorn and a big glass of wine to watch the picture show on Sunday when Anderson interviews her. And I think Ken is absolutely right. I think she is a businesswoman. I think she's a smart woman and a businesswoman. But here's the thing. Look, if you got no issue with Donald Trump promoting his properties, using the presidency to promote his properties and jacking up the prices of Mar-a-Lago as a result of being president, if you've got no issue with Jared Kushner trying to negotiate financing from people who have all sorts of conflicts of interest.
Gotta run, Anna.
If you've got no issue with Ivanka trying to hawk bracelets during interviews, then certainly you can't have issues with Stormy Daniels trying to make a little money off this presidency, too. Yeah. It should not be a right solely reserved for Trumps and Kushners.
Yeah. Sunday night. Don't know why there's no sun up in the sky. Stormy Daniels. Thank you, guys. Appreciate it. When we come back, why the president tweets about anything and everything except Stormy Daniels. This is CNN Tonight. I'm Don Lemon. It is 11 p.m. here on the East Coast, live with breaking news on the Russia investigation. We're learning more tonight about what Robert Mueller's team is focusing on. Here's what sources are telling CNN, that the special counsel wants to question President Trump about four main topics so far, anyway. The president's role in crafting a misleading statement about Trump Jr.'s infamous meeting with Russians during the campaign, the circumstances surrounding that Trump Tower meeting, and the firing of FBI Director James Comey and the National Security Advisor Michael Flynn. Source also says the president's legal team is creating a list of dozens of potential questions Mueller's team could ask. And with Trump already angry about the Mueller investigation and blasting it as a witch hunt, CNN has learned the president was fuming last night when news leaked that his national security advisors had warned him, in all caps, by the way, not to congratulate Vladimir Putin on his reelection. The president reportedly quizzed his allies and outside advisors, asking them to tell him who they thought was the leaker. We're going to get to all of that. And I want to bring in now CNN contributor Frank Bruni of the New York Times. Frank, thank you very much. The president is defending, you know, via Twitter, his congratulatory call. We're going to get to that. He's furious about the leaks. He said that it happened in the first place, that all caps, not to congratulate. Also, he's attacking Robert Mueller on Twitter as well. But he's not attacking one person, and that is Stormy Daniels, and that is the subject of your latest column called The Calm Before the Stormy. Why do you think that is?
I don't know why it is, but I think it's an interesting question to ask, and I spend the column basically looking at some of the possible answers. Because when you pull back and you think about the way the president usually behaves, and all of the people who've not been exempt from his attacks. You know, he attacked the mayor of San Juan while they're still reeling from a hurricane. He attacked the mayor of London right after they'd been victims of a terrorist attack. Like, he is not someone who lays off because he thinks it's indelicate or this person can't stand the heat. So why, as she is out there saying she's about to talk about their affair, as she's out there representing, you know, something that could really be a problem for him, why utter silence from him? And I think there are a couple possible answers, one of which is, you know, this is an area of his life, the erotic area of his life, that has been one of the pillars of his vanity. And maybe it really freaks him out that somebody out there is about to, well, and she did in a 2011 In Touch magazine interview, and it wasn't a very flattering portrait of the president as Lothario. Maybe that really gets under his skin. I know that sounds tawdry, but we're talking about Donald Trump here, and we're talking about someone who one of his proudest moments in his life was a headline that said, best sex I've ever had.
Well, I mean, yes. Thank you for saying that. We are, you know, gentlemen of a certain age, and so we remember all of those. We remember all of those headlines and the person that Donald Trump used to be, the character here in New York, and how the trades and the tabloids and the magazines would write about him. And it was often in the terms that you just mentioned. So I have to ask you, do you think it doesn't bother him? Maybe he thinks it's okay, or is he really, really, really rattled by this?
Well, I think it could be a little bit of both, and in fact, I think it is a little bit of both. But I'm glad you brought that up, because he may feel that to have, in his eyes, beautiful desirable women out there saying, I slept with Donald Trump, he may actually see that as a badge of honor. But I think it also does rattle him, because let's talk about another figure here, Melania. By all outward evidence, this is not a marriage that's going through its smoothest moment. They're spending less time together. All of this is happening in the context of a very chaotic White House. I don't think he wants any further strain in that relationship, and it's my educated opinion, guess, you know, some knowledge, that every time Stormy Daniels comes up, every time, you know, the playmate that he had an affair with, or supposedly had an affair with, comes up, I think that mortifies her, I think it diminishes her, and I don't think it does any favors to the marriage, you know, or to the stability of the White House and his home life.
And I get, you said supposed to, and again, these are all allegations, this is all alleged, right. Even well, Stormy Daniels did, you were going to mention that.
I was going to say they're alleged, but one of the kind of things we don't talk about much here is, why would you pay someone to sign a non-disclosure agreement if there's nothing to disclose?
That is a very good question.
It's like the riddle of the Sphinx,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah. So one person the president is no longer afraid to call out or attack by name is Robert Mueller. Why do you suppose that changed?
I think because the investigation's gotten further along. I think, you know, you just talked at the beginning of this about it getting so far along that they're talking about exactly what sort of questions they might ask Donald Trump about. I think he's feeling the heat in a new way, and if the termination of this investigation is a kind of judgment or verdict that is damaging to his presidency, he wants to discredit the accusers. He wants to say, this was tarnished from the start and you could never have trusted Robert Mueller.
You don't think it's laying the groundwork, though, to fire Mueller?
I am still on the camp that believes he won't go that far, because I don't think he's so far gone that he thinks he could do that and not end up with a constitutional crisis and with a presidency that is effectively at that moment over.
So he's really angry about the leaks, though, and that there are larger problems that are stemming from this White House. There's all the chaos, all the people who are being fired. And he's upset because someone possibly leaked something. And, you know, as I was talking to David Axelrod and others, every White House has leaks.
Yeah.
This one more than others, and maybe that's because they just don't. They don't trust this president.
Every White House has leaks, but this latest leak, you know, the do not congratulate him, and he went ahead and congratulated him. It's a particular, it says something particular that most leaks don't. It says the people around him don't trust him to behave correctly, and it says that they're acting sort of as minders. And that's an extremely humiliating portrait of yourself, and I think that's why this leak in particular is unusual and bothers him so much.
Shouldn't he learn that you have to earn trust? Rather than having people take loyalty oaths, that you have to learn them.
This verb learn, coupled with Donald Trump, keeps troubling me, because I have not noticed that this is a man who learns a whole lot. So
I asked you that earlier.
I think we did talk about his absence. No, that's right.
My bad again. Listen, I know that you want to deconstruct the president's tweets defending his congratulatory call to Putin. So let's start with the first one. He says, I call President Trump on Russia to congratulate him on his election victory. In past, Obama called him also. The fake news media is crazed because they wanted me to excoriate him. They are wrong. Getting along with Russia and others is a good thing, not a bad thing. He says getting along with Russia and others, a good thing, not a bad thing. And you say?
I say that's one of the funniest lines I've ever read in one of his tweets, because if getting along with Russia and other places or other countries is a good thing, why is he constantly alienating our allies? Why is he taking on Angela Merkel, and to the point where she's going out and saying maybe Europe needs to think about its security by itself? Why is he bragging about having lied to the Prime Minister of Canada? He's not trying to get along with everybody. He's trying to get along with Vladimir Putin, and it's an interesting crowd of one whom he's most concerned with.
Mm-hmm. Did you see the interview with John Brennan, who said that they must have something on him?
Yes.
He said he was just speculating. What do you make of that? That Putin must have something on him?
Well, I think it's what everyone's been wondering, if that's what's going on, because his hands-off treatment of Putin, his utter inability or unwillingness to fully acknowledge and act on what Russia did in terms of meddling with our elections, it begs an explanation, and one of the obvious explanations is Putin has something on him. Now, I'm not saying I believe that, and I didn't like hearing John Brennan say it, because I think whenever we go too far, we feed Trump's persecution narrative, and we feed the belief among his supporters that none of us can be fair to him. And I think we can be fair to him, but we have big, urgent questions here.
Second part of the tweet that I read before, it says, they can help solve problems with North Korea, talking about Russia. They can help solve problems with North Korea, Syria, Ukraine, ISIS, Iran, and even the coming arms race. Bush tried to get along, but didn't have the smarts. Obama and Clinton tried, but they didn't have the energy and chemistry. Remember, reset, peace through strength. So he doesn't attack. Vladimir Putin, but he attacks his predecessors, he attacks Obama, and he says, what does he get out of saying that Bush doesn't have the smarts?
I don't know, and why is smarts in quotation marks? I think it's hilarious that he's writing a sentence talking about if someone else isn't smart, and he's doing this Trump Twitter tick of putting random words in quotation marks as if that's some artful and elevated thing, when really it's just nonsensical.
He's trusting Russia, because he says here, they can really help us out in Ukraine. He's trusting Russia to solve Ukraine?
Well, you know, Don, because they've been such a portrait of international altruism through time and in the past. Of course, Russia wants nothing more than to help us with our diplomatic and foreign relations problems.
Frank Bruni, thank you very much. I appreciate it. When we come back, a CNN exclusive, Facebook's Mark Zuckerberg breaks his silence on the Cambridge Analytica scandal, what he says he'll do to make sure Americans' personal information is safe. Facebook's Mark Zuckerberg speaking exclusively to CNN tonight, apologizing for the data debacle that has Facebook under fire and saying he'd be willing to testify before Congress. CNN's senior media correspondent, Mr. Brian Stelter, is here. He's the host of CNN's Reliable Sources, and CNN national security analyst Julia Cayenne, and former official at the Department of Homeland Security. She joins us as well. The Facebook CEO, Mark Zuckerberg, speaking exclusively tonight to our colleague, Laura Siegel. Let's listen to it, and then we'll discuss.
The reality here is that this isn't rocket science, right? I mean, there's a lot of hard work that we need to do to make it harder for nation states like Russia to do election interference, to make it so that trolls and other folks can't spread fake news. But we can get in front of this. And we have a responsibility to do this, not only for the 2018 midterms in the U.S., which are going to be a huge deal this year, and that's just a huge focus of us, but there's a big election in India this year. There's a big election in Brazil. There are big elections around the world. And you can bet that we are really committed to doing everything that we need to make sure that the integrity of those elections on Facebook is secured.
Brian Stelter, what stood out to you in Zuckerberg's comments?
That he's looking to the future, thinking about how to avoid some of the embarrassments of the past. You know, this scandal that's consumed almost a week is about data from 2014 that might have been misused in the 2016 presidential election, but we're now close to the midterms. People are already thinking about 2020. And as Zuckerberg said, it's not just about the U.S., it's about countries all around the world. Facebook is now a global player. It influences elections, whether it wants to be a part of them or not. Mm-hmm. So Zuckerberg is at least saying the right things. He's talking the talk. We have to see if this company is going to walk the walk in the future. Mm-hmm. But I thought this was a positive step that he's talking about security, saying they're hiring more people, trying to manage what is all over Facebook. Because let's make no mistake, the Russian trolls that tried to attack the U.S. in 2016, they're going to get more creative in future elections, and it's not just going to be Russia.
And you mentioned the 2016 election, and he talked about election meddling. Juliet, let's listen and then we'll talk.
Yeah. Knowing what you know now, do you believe Facebook impacted the results of the 2016 election?
Oh, that is hard. You know, I think that it's really hard for me to have a full assessment of that. You know, it's the reality is, well, there were so many different forces at play, right? The organic posting that people did, the get out the vote campaigns that we ran, the pages that both candidates ran, the advertising that they did. I'm sure that all of that activity had some impact.
So, Juliet, can Facebook's potential to influence people be dialed back at this point?
I think it can. And, you know, like what Brian said, I think Mark Zuckerberg is looking forward. But I don't give him a buy. I mean, in other words, there was a little bit of victimization in the interview. And what people have to remember is that Facebook, there's a difference between what Facebook does and how it makes money. What it does is it brings us together. We get to see pictures of our nieces and nephews, communicate with our college roommates, all the fun stuff we love. That's not how it makes money. It makes money by gathering intelligence on its users and selling it. We're used to that being advertisers. We all know they do that with advertisers. But in this case, they got caught that some of that information was sold to a company involved with sort of very anti-democratic practices and candidates, and also involved with the Trump campaign. So how did they all of a sudden realize it? You know, I don't buy that they sort of woke up to it. They knew about it a couple years ago. It's just there's a difference between what they do and how they make money. They are now going to focus on making money more responsibly. But they're a company. They're not, they're not a platform. They're a company that wants to make lots of money, and now they're willing to make less.
And they lost billions this year. But are they back
Yeah, Brian. This week, you know, $50 billion wiped off the value of the stock. The stock's down 8% for the week, but it did bounce back a little bit today. Maybe investors saw a buying opportunity.
But when she said
look,
it's
we
a
haven't
business,
seen that before.
That's why, that's why I brought it up. But listen, and to Juliet's point, Brian, he said that they fixed the issue long ago that led to this breach. But still, I mean, millions of people's personal information was compromised. Do you think that they can fix that so it doesn't happen again?
Yeah, Facebook, you know, think of a room with lots of doors. Yes, they've locked this door. Doesn't mean they've locked every door as securely as they need to. And I think users, when they hear about this story, this scandal from years ago, they wonder about their security today because there could be new ways to misuse data today. I think what is good about this controversy and what's great about Zuckerberg speaking out is that it's a chance for all of us to reevaluate our relationships with these giant social networking sites. You know, I signed up when I was in college. You probably signed up a decade ago, right? I don't think we were all thinking about the fact that we were giving over so much of our data and our personal information to these giant tech companies.
Before I get to, and I have a question about Cambridge Analytica for you, Juliet, but I do have to say, I don't, and this is me personally, and some of the people I know, I find myself not going onto Facebook as much because it became so toxic. It was the comments were sore. The fake news. I would see things that, you know, had CNN on it, and I was like, that is not a CNN product. And you click on it, and there was no CNN product. I wonder how many people are feeling the same sort of thing that I'm feeling.
Facebook is starting to see that. They are starting to see a decline in time spent, and that actually is the big threat to their business model, because if you rely less on Facebook in your life, that's the threat to their business model.
Mm. So let's talk about, this is a bigger issue to you here, I'm sure you'll agree, and that is the Cambridge Analytica part of this. Able to exploit this data, Julia, or to the fact that Facebook made it so easily available. What do you think of that?
This is just a challenge here because it's like, who are you going to believe right now? So Cambridge Analytica clearly did something wrong in the sense that it bought information that should have not been gathered, at least under Facebook's rules. On the other hand, Facebook knew that it had happened and didn't notify it or try to shut it down. In fact, let's just be honest here. It did not kick Cambridge Analytica off its platform until Friday night, a few hours before Matt and others posted their story in the New York Times.
Right.
So, you know, there's a sort of, you know, timing issue here about what Facebook knew and how engaged they were to stop it. So I'm just going back to my first point, which is there's a reason why they didn't do this before, and that's because their business model depends on the selling of information. Hmm. That business model will have to change, or we will have to change, one or the other. Hmm. But it's, you know, we just have to face up to it that Facebook is not the victim here.
Yeah, go ahead, Brian. What'd you
know, I was thinking about Cambridge Analytica and what they're going to face. Facebook certainly under pressure to come and testify on Capitol Hill. Zuckerberg said tonight he's willing to come to Capitol Hill. That's a big change for him. He also said they're open to regulation. That's a big change for Facebook. So again, they're saying the right things.
Did he say media should be? He thinks social media should be regulated.
He said it's not a matter of whether to regulate; it's how to do it. So he's opening the door to the idea of some regulation. I don't think he's expecting dramatic changes, but maybe some regulation.
Yeah.
But
Julia,
Cambridge Analytica could be in criminal trouble. You know, Robert Mueller has asked for Cambridge Analytica's documents. So I think that's an important note here.
That's the question. That's what I want to ask Juliet, because it's whether this information, the question of whether Cambridge Analytica or anyone from the Trump campaign provided the Russians with this raw Facebook data that then this disinformation campaign that somehow influenced the election. That is the big, and will Robert Mueller look into that?
Well, he is looking into that. And remember, in his indictments against the Russians, Facebook is mentioned several times. So there is this sort of not yet proved connection between all of these different actors. What I will say is the Trump campaign's insistence now that Cambridge Analytica was a, you know, second-rate data management firm that had nothing to do. That had nothing to do with the Trump campaign is a bogus explanation today. We all know that when Trump won, there was a lot of focus on the data team, which was led by or chaired by Jared Kushner, and what they were able to do with what information Cambridge Analytica had. So there are strong ties. Whether you whether Mueller is connecting all of those circles, we don't know yet, but he is looking right now.
That's got to be the last word. But thank you. Fascinating conversation. I could talk to you both about it all night. And it would be great if Facebook would want people like me who have become, you know, a little bit disillusioned
with
Facebook.
They need to make it a safe neighborhood.
Absolutely.
That's the bottom line.
Thank you. Appreciate it. When we come back, we're learning exactly what Robert Mueller wants to talk to the president about, and we're going to tell you what he is focused on and how the president's lawyers might be preparing.